If you enjoy Legends of Bass, please consider supporting me on Patreon. My patrons have access to great rewards, like bass tabs for every piece I play in this video. Click the link in the description to learn more. What's up, YouTube? John here with another episode of Legends of Bass. This marks our final episode on John Entwistle, part 4 of 4. So far, we covered so many of his great bass lines throughout his whole career with The Who, and today we're going to wrap that up. Before we get down to that, I just wanted to give a big shout out to my patrons on Patreon, especially Chris Slade. Thanks a lot for your contribution, Chris. Really appreciate it. So before we get down to all the great bass lines throughout the rest of John's career, let's just go back to where we were in the last video. You may recall we ended with Quadrophenia. In fact, the whole last episode was on Quadrophenia and all the great bass lines that were on it. So just to set the stage a little bit, it was 1973, it was the Quadrophenia tour, and as I mentioned in the previous video, it was fraught with a lot of technical issues. There was problems going on with the backing tracks for all the string arrangements and stuff. Roger and Pete were fighting. And this was also a very reckless time for the band, especially for Keith Moon. This is actually the tour where he infamously passed out behind the drum set in the middle of a show, and Pete had to fish somebody out of the audience to actually finish the set, because I think it only happened during the second or third song. You can actually find the video online of this. He actually did that again at another show later on the tour, so he was really at pretty much an all-time low of his alcohol and drug abuse at the time, which made all of the other issues even more difficult and really made the tour drag on. This also was a period of great destruction for the band, both in hotel rooms, especially one night where Keith actually destroyed his whole room, and he cut his hand in the process, and he passed out, and he almost bled out if their manager didn't come looking for him and find him passed out on the floor. He could have been killed then. And there was another hotel room destruction by the band, which got them actually arrested by the Canadian federal police in Montreal. So just a wild time. This is a big time where they really, you know, were the loudest band in the world and all that. So the Quadrophenia tour basically ran right up to the end of 1973. And in 1974, work began on the Tommy film. Now this film was quite big. It wasn't just some B actors. It actually had a lot of big musicians, including Eric Clapton, Elton John, Tina Turner, and several others. The film actually was highly praised. It even earned Pete an Oscar nomination for Best Original Score. But with all the work around the film, the band only played a handful of shows that year, one festival slot, and a few dates at Madison Square Garden. And after that, they wouldn't play live again for over a year. So that takes us to about 1975, which had a rocky start with Pete and Roger dissing each other in interviews to the press because they couldn't agree on really what the future of the band was or the direction they wanted to go in. Pete was sort of depressed about the state of the band and sort of his outlook on the future of his career and the band, and he feared that The Who may be starting to become irrelevant with all the new bands and genres coming out in the mid-70s. This sentiment was reflected throughout the album's many introspective songs. This album, by the way, that we're talking about is the next one after Quadrophenia, which is The Who by Numbers. As I mentioned, he was really detached, and so was the rest of the band. The recording process was really sort of dragged out. The band would frequently take breaks and just randomly go to the bar or go outside between takes, which really made everything drag on for a long time. However, nonetheless, in October of 75, they released the album. The big single off that was Squeeze Box, and that did find some commercial success. But other than that, there weren't too many super hits as with the previous albums. But nonetheless, some great bass playing here, and I've picked two tracks in particular from The Who by Numbers. The first one is Slip Kid, which is the lead-off song, and it actually was targeted to be a single itself, but it didn't really chart well, wasn't that popular. But the song itself is a little bit about the themes I mentioned, Pete's disillusionment with the music industry. Apparently it has to do with him sort of writing a letter to the youth. You know, he's sort of giving this anthem saying, you know, don't get into music like I did or you'll get hurt. You know, it won't be the best career path, maybe, let's put it that way. Anyway, regarding the bass line, it's simple but effective, pretty straightforward, but some good walking pieces in there. Anyway, here it is, Slip Kid from The Who by Numbers. Pete actually has been quoted as saying that this is one of his least favorite songs to play live. In fact, he hates it, along with Sister Disco, which is one we'll cover in a few minutes. But I think it's a great track. It's a really fiery track. It's got brilliant little bass flourishes from Entwistle throughout. There's about two or three of them, and I picked out my personal favorite ones here. The basic idea behind the song is that the protagonist is sort of chastising themselves for not being able to control their sexual urges. You know, they go out there, they make fools of themselves, maybe, perhaps, and they're sort of angry with themselves. It sort of plays off another song on the album where Pete addresses his drinking problems. So it's sort of, you know, again, introspective, but nonetheless, it's a real fun one, great bass in it. Here it is, Dreaming from the Waist. On a 70-day tour to support the Who by Numbers, and along the way they set some cool records. One was an attendance record for the largest indoor concert, which was at the Pontiac Silverdome, which had 78,000 attendees, and the other was the loudest rock concert, where they were recorded, I believe it was at a festival, at over 120 decibels. So, you know, they don't call them the loudest band in rock and roll for nothing. At the end of the tour, Pete said that he was fed up with touring and wanted to take an extended break. John Entwistle, on the other hand, felt that the band were at their live peak and that they were playing pretty much better than ever. Nonetheless, The Who would take the next year off and wouldn't perform live for another 14 months. During this time, the band began to sort of drift apart. Each member got involved in solo work, and unfortunately, Keith Moon's drug and alcohol problems continued to intensify. when it finally came time to record songs for the next album, Who Are You, the sessions had a lot of issues and delays, similar to what we saw with the previous one, The Who by Numbers. Roger had throat surgery, which delayed all the recording sessions. There were a lot of technical and audio problems because they were using some new equipment at a different studio, and they would record things and then go back the next day and everything sounded different. So there was a lot of technical issues. There were disagreements with the producers. Roger actually had a disagreement with one of them. It was Glyn Johns, and actually knocked him out in a disagreement. And just things continued to be exacerbated. The band again was generally unmotivated to work. They didn't really have the passion that they had with previous albums. As I mentioned, Keith's problems with drugs and alcohol continued to intensify, and as a result, his drumming was greatly deteriorated when they went to record his parts in the studio. He needed a conducting from the producer to let him know and cue him. He didn't really do his homework, didn't know when he should come in on certain songs. There's another song that was in 6/8 time, which he just couldn't even play, so they ended up removing drums completely. So really, this recording session for Who Are You was arguably even worse than The Who by Numbers. But either way, the album was finally released in October of 1979, and it was a big success, both critically and commercially. It hit number 2 on the Billboard charts, sort of brought The Who back to the forefront of rock. They sort of had maybe slipped into the wings a little bit, but this was a big album. Who Are You was a smash hit. And they were sort of back into center stage, if you will. Tragically, Keith Moon passed away just 1 month after the album's release. The band turned to the drummer of The Faces and The Small Faces, Kenny Jones, to fill in for the upcoming tour. It's actually quite an interesting thing. I actually have a copy of the vinyl here, and one of the things that people always talk about is, you could see that, let me make sure that's in the frame there, you could see Keith sitting in the center, and the chair that he says not to be taken away. I think that's in focus, but you can look it up online if you can't see it. People just thought that was a sad coincidence that he died just a month after, and it says not to be taken away on his chair there. Interesting coincidence. Anyhow, there are 3 Entwistle songs on this album, and that actually was a theme that started with this album, where from here on out, basically, Entwistle penned at least 2 to 3 songs per album. The first one I'm going to talk about, though, is Sister Disco. This is an interesting one. It's got some great bass in it. I'm not really sure what the theme is. It seems to be debated online. People aren't really sure, but it's sort of, the lyrics imply that the protagonist is sort of mourning the death of disco, you know, saying goodbye to it. But at the same time, I read that Pete has said in the past that the song is about how The Who would never sort of do a Bee Gees thing and become sort of poppy, or, you know, they wanted to maintain, it's him basically saying, you know, screw disco, we're going to be rock forever. It's one of those things, we're not really sure. But anyway, great bass on this song. Starts off with the cool bass chords at the beginning. Sure, he could have played one note, but why not play power chords? Then you go into this cool sliding thing where he's sliding up the neck and back down on the verses. Then you get to that little pre-chorus part, and he plays those super fast 16th notes. Really cool part there, and it goes along with that program synthesizer, sequencer, whatever it is. And then when you get to the chorus, there's even another style. It's sort of almost like a classical guitar, classical music style arrangement on the bass, where he plays this great melody over the chorus, and it just flows really nicely. Sounds really cool. Check it out. Sister Disco. As I walked through that hospital door, I was sewn up like a glove. I got a smile from the light of the wind. Watch the fresh fall of snow. Yeah. next song I want to talk about from Who Are You is one that John himself wrote. It's called Trick of the Light. Another interesting theme here. It's apparently about a man who's a little bit nervous about how his performance in bed was, and that's what the lyrics are indicative of anyway. The song is pretty interesting from a bass perspective because there's actually two bass tracks going on. One is John's, one of his eight-string basses. So what you have going on there is a bass string and basically a guitar string for each normal string. So instead of an E, A, D, G, you got an E bass string and an E guitar string for the E, the same for the A, and so forth. So it kind of gives you a 12-string effect where you have the bass string and then you're getting an octave higher from the guitar string or the thinner bass string. Creates for a really cool sound, and that's what you hear at the intro. It's this sort of loud, sort of shredding, distorted sound, and that's actually the 8-string bass. So that sounds really cool, but that alone wouldn't be enough to sort of hold down the song and keep a rhythm. So there's also just a regular low-end bass underneath playing some cool, mostly roots on the chords, but some cool little walking pieces and whatnot. That one ends up mixing with the two, and at a few parts in the song, you can actually hear both at the same time. So hats off to the engineer who mixed those two together. I like this song a lot. It shows John's sort of more hard rock, riffy edge, which you see on a few other songs in this video. But anyway, here it is, Trick of the Light. Who doesn't know Who Are You? It's one of the biggest songs that Who ever put out. Probably their biggest, certainly their biggest late hit in these last few albums here. You've heard it everywhere. Huge hit. Funny enough, as I was reading and doing the research for the video, I found this cool fact, which I actually never heard before. The whole sort of story of the song is inspired by a real life thing that happened to Pete around the time of the writing. The production, for the pre-production for this album, when they were writing the songs, he went to a bar. You know, he was still sort of in this depressive state. He was, you know, doing a lot of drinking, and he met up with a couple guys from the Sex Pistols at a bar, got real drunk, and actually passed out on the way out. And that's where he got that opening line and a little bit of the story, which is, I woke up in a Soho door where a policeman knew my name. Be-do-do-do-do-do. So it was his own personal experience that inspired the song. What I really like about it is it's a pretty straight bass line. You know, for the most part during the choruses, you're just hearing that simple E octave. But I love the intro, sort of a typical Entwistle. Gotta, you know, do a couple flourishes and some cool little walk down things in the beginning, some cool little riffy things. And then as we get into the actual song, the verse that is, there's a cool sort of rhythmic thing where, you know, it's sort of catching the upbeat. And it has a cool style that when you're maybe playing the song on your own, you'll have to realize that it's sort of, you have to catch the upbeat. It's a cool rhythm. Great song. I true classic, a true legend. Here it is. Who are you? Aside from the Who Are You tour, the Who were involved with two different film projects. One was the release of the Quadrophenia movie. The other was a retrospective documentary about the band's history and their upcoming and whatever, and that was called The Kids Are All Right. So both of these film projects were happening, as well as the wrap-up of the Who Are You tour. John was heavily involved with the Quadrophenia soundtrack for the movie, which actually had some alternate versions of those songs. Pretty cool. If you get some time, check those out. The Real Me, which is one of his famous bass lines, was completely redone on the soundtrack version. Something cool to check out. In 1980, the band began work on their next album, which was Face Dances, and this was the first album with their new drummer, Kenny Jones. The big hit off of this is probably You Better You Bet, still a live staple to this day. You know, it's got that great sort of pop rock feel that everyone can sort of enjoy. And once again, like the other few songs we've talked about so far, it's got a great mix of styles. In the beginning, you open up really high on the neck, which is sort of an Entwistle trademark, you know, playing those high chords and high notes up top. And then once the song drops in, he goes into just a straight digging eighth notes, you know, right along, marching along on the verse. Until you get to the pre-chorus, where he does an interesting sort of double stop slap thing, which are really the main chords holding down that section of the song, because there's some piano, you know, runs and stuff that go over that. For the most part, it's John's bass that's holding it down. And then the chorus is pretty straightforward, but it's just a great pop rocker, and of course John makes it anything but simple. Here it is, You Better You Bet. You better 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 going to talk about from Face Dances is The Quiet One. This is a song that John Entwistle wrote and that he sang on and performed live. And he actually wrote it with the specific purpose of replacing My Wife, which was the main song that he was had been performing in their live sets since that was released earlier in the 70s on Who's Next. So I think he was just getting tired of performing that and Boris the Spider. So he wanted a new song to play, and that's what The Quiet One was. It's a cool rocker, similar to Trick of the Light. It's got sort of that heavy feel. This one's real fast, real fun, some great fills in there, some triplets on the verses. In fact, throughout the whole verses, that's sort of the rhythm that he's picking. And then there's some really great fills on the chorus. And then if you, in the end of the clip you're about to see, he does this really cool fill. I'm sure it was improvised. He's very good like that, you know. Anyway, here it is, The Quiet One. Face Dances is How Can You Do It Alone. Now this is one I actually hadn't heard previous to doing my research here. I consider myself a pretty big Who fan, but I don't know every song on every album. And this is one I actually hadn't heard, but I like it a lot. It's got a pretty simple chorus and intro, but where Entwistle really shines is on the verses, where he plays, at least for him, a pretty rare, basically a funky sort of slapping and popping bass line, which I haven't really heard on. I've heard some heavy finger style stuff where it sounds like slapping, but I think this was true slap and pop style. So at least that's how I played it. I thought it was a great bass line. It just really makes the song have that great upbeat feel over the piano. Check it out. Here it is. How Can You Do It Alone? Talk about from Face Dances is You. Now, You was originally intended to be a solo song that John presented to drummer Kenny Jones. The two of them were jamming together. And John pulled that out and was playing it, and Kenny thought it was really great, and John said, I've been working on it, it's going to be on my next solo album, I think I'm going to record it soon. And Kenny said, no way, man, that's a great Who song, you got to hold that until we record again in 6 months or whatever. And so he convinced him, and he did. It was never actually performed live by The Who, but John did play it in his solo career with the John Entwistle Band and some other projects. I really like it. It's cool, riffy. It's got a great intro. And where I really like is the sort of overdriven tone that is on the verses. Pretty similar to what John's later, you know, late 70s on, his live tone, that like very trebly, overdriven sound. And even what he played up until he passed away in the early 2000s, his live tone, that sort of grungy, overdriven treble sound. So I did my best to mimic that here. Check it out. You. Face Dances tour, that takes us to about 1982, and the band were ready to put out what would be their last album together before they called it quits. It's the last Who album that John Entwistle played bass on. That album is called It's Hard. This album also has 2 to 3 John Entwistle songs on it, the first of which is called Dangerous, and this was actually from a rock opera that John was working on, similar to what Pete had done in the past with Quadrophenia and Tommy and others. It was ultimately abandoned. Some of the songs went into Who Are You, and then this one, Dangerous, was on their last album, It's Hard. John probably recorded it on one of his expensive Alembic boutique 24-fret super basses, but since I don't have one of those at my disposal, nor do I have a 24-fret bass, I just used some pitch shifting in post here to just tune that part up an octave. It's not a particularly long clip. I just wanted to show sort of his high range going from the top of the neck all the way down. And then this great melody he plays in the pre-verse, intro, whatever you want to call it. And just a little snippet of the verse. Here it is, Dangerous. To the last Who song we're going to talk about from the last Who album and the last John Entwistle episode of Legends of Bass, and that song is Eminence Front. Now, Eminence Front was sort of a sleeper hit for the band in the sense that, you know, Pete and Roger, this album and the previous album, they really weren't that attached to the material. They didn't really love the material. Roger was actually quoted as saying that Eminence Front was the only song on the album that should have been released. But you know, the albums came out anyway. I think there's some other good songs there. Go figure. But anyhow, Eminence Front, big song for The Who. They're still playing it to this day. It's been in countless movies, commercials, radio shows, mostly probably due to that great sequenced synthesizer intro that Pete spent a ton of hours planning out and working out. And it's got that great lead-in guitar solo that he normally would improvise differently each night, and he's still doing that now. But, you know, it's a pretty simple song. It's Pete's sort of ode to the wealthy who hide their problems in their facade of partying and drug use and just that whole, you know, excess sort of thing. From a bass perspective, it's pretty simple when it starts off. On the verses, you're just hearing basically two notes. It's a two-chord progression back and forth. But where it really gets good is on the first chorus. John starts with a second layered bass, much like we talked about with Trick of the Light, where he had sort of a lead riffy bass and then a low end bass just to hold down the rhythm in the low end. That's sort of the case here too. He's got one bass that's just playing the two root notes that really holds down the low end, and then when the first chorus starts, he just starts going into this sort of slappy, sort of funky, you know, improvised basically bass solo, and that continues more or less throughout the whole song. That's why another reason why this was a great live staple, because John would just, you know, open up and totally just go crazy all over the place. It's a great live staple, great Who song. One other little tidbit I wanted to mention about it was that it's one of the few Who songs that I've heard and learned that is downtuned. So it's actually in it's a half step down, and it's actually in sort of drop D. So really you have a C sharp on the E string, so it's real low, and then the rest of your strings are in a half step. So real low one here. Had to really take it down a notch. Anyway, guys, here it is, Eminence Front. The girls smile, people forget. On John Entwistle. Never thought I would go this far, but basically every time I say I want to make these videos shorter, I only end up making more episodes that are longer. I'm really going to try for future episodes. John Entwistle is a personal favorite, so I had to really show all of his great bass lines, and even some new ones that I learned along the way. Other than that, though, guys, I just want to say, if you're interested in learning these songs, check out my Patreon page where I tab out all of the songs for each episode. Get on there, become a patron. You can vote on future players that I cover. You can vote on which songs of theirs I cover. A lot of great perks to be had there. Anyway, guys, as usual, please subscribe to this channel. Please like it if you enjoyed the video. Leave me a comment of what you thought. Let me know who you want to see covered in the future. Subscribe, check out my band. Thanks so much for watching, guys, and stay tuned for the next episode of Legends of Bass.